لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة لمن كان يرجو الله واليوم الآخر وذكر الله كثيرا.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. قال المؤلف: باب سباب العبيد. حدثنا آدم قال حدثنا شعبة قال حدثنا واسل الأحدب قال سمعت المعرور بن زبيد يقول: رأيت أبا ذر وعليه حلة وعلى غلامه حلة، فسألناه عن ذلك فقال: إني سببت رجلا فشكاني إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، فقال لي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: أعيرته بأمك؟ قلت: نعم. ثم قال: إن إخوانكم خوالكم جعلهم الله تحت أيديكم، فمن كان أخوه تحت يديه فليطعمه مما يأكل ويلبسه مما يلبس، ولا تكلفوهم ما يغلبهم، فإن كلفتموهم ما يغلبهم فأعينوهم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We continue with the kitab Al-Adab Al-Mufrad by Imam Al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala. And we are currently going through the section pertaining to slaves. And Imam Al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala begins a new chapter. He says, Babu Sibab Al-Abid, the chapter of insulting the slave. The chapter of insulting the slaves. So has anything been mentioned regarding insulting the slaves from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companions? This is what Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala will speak about in this chapter. So he gives the hadith of al-Ma'rur ibn Suwayd. He said, رَأَيْتُ أَبَا ذَرٍ وَعَلَيْهِ حُلَّةٌ وَعَلَى غُلَامِهِ حُلَّةٌ. He said, I saw Aba Dharr radiallahu anhu, and upon him was a robe, and upon his slave was also a robe. فَسَأَلْنَاهُ عَنْ ذَلِكَ. So we asked him about this. And the reason why this was surprising to some of those who saw the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is because it is from the tradition of the masters to dress in a better way than their slaves. And they wouldn't usually dress as their slaves dressed. But we know from the previous lesson that the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, wa albisuhum mimma talbasun, that make them wear that which you wear, and they used to share their garments with their slaves. So if they had a complete suit and only one of them or two different types of suits, then they would wear half of them and their companions or their slaves would wear the other half, so they would treat them equally. So when they saw Abu Dharr radiallahu an and he was dressed like this and his slave was also dressed like him, they asked him about it. So he said to them, إِنِّي سَابَدْتُ رَجُلًا فَشَكَانِي إِلَى النَّبِيِّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. He said, indeed I insulted someone, and then they complained about me to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. فَقَالَ لِلنَّبِيُّ صلى الله عليه وسلم. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said to me, أَعَيَّرْتَهُ بِأُمِّهِ. Did you insult him through his mother? So then I replied, yes, نعم. ثم قال then the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم completed the hadith. Now Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu is talking about an incident that took place between him and Bilal radiallahu anhu. And Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, he was a noble companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And some people will say there are many ahadith pertaining to Abu Dharr that shows that he had a harsh character. And this is because the background of Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, that he was from the A'rab, he was from the Bedouins. And the Bedouins were known to be harsh. They were known to be severe in their speech and their actions and their dealings with people. So when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made hijrah from Mecca to Medina, and the Ansar, the people of Medina, they welcomed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they didn't have the same nurturing as the Muhajirun, those who migrated from Mecca to Medina. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he was with the Muhajirun in Mecca, he gave them the tarbiyah of al-Islam for 13 years. So he taught them the etiquettes and the manners of a believer.
And then when they went to Medina, the people of Ansar didn't have the same etiquettes as those of the Muhajirun. Some of them were the Bedouins from the deserts. Some of them were living upon Jahiliyyah, upon the pre-Islamic characteristics that they had nurtured from their forefathers. So you would find in the first few years of migration, the Prophet ﷺ taught them about the adab and the akhlaq of the believer, about the morals and the etiquettes of the believers. So Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu was from the A'rab, he was from the Bedouins. So he had this harsh character. So when he saw Bilal radiallahu anhu, he insulted him through his mother. That your mother, she was dark in her skin, and he insulted him in a racist manner. So in another riwayah, in another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, إِنَّكَ مْرُؤٌ فِيكَ جَاهِلِيَّةٌ. That you are a man that you still have this jahiliyyah in you. You still have these characteristics that the disbelievers have. And this is something that you need to change. So Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, he took this from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he understood this and he began to implement this in his life. Because when we look at the creation in the sight of Allah Jalla wa Ala, Allah Jalla wa Ala says, إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. The most honorable of you in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are those that have the most taqwa, those that perform the most good deeds, those that stay away from haram and evil. They are the most honorable in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah Jalla wa Ala doesn't look at the color of our skin. Allah Jalla wa Ala doesn't look at our gender. Allah Jalla wa Ala doesn't look at our height, or our weight, or our strength. Allah Jalla wa Ala looks at our taqwa. He looks at our piety. How we obey Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, and how a person disobeys Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is what Allah Jalla wa Ala looks at. So when Abu Dharr radiallahu an, he insulted Bilal radiallahu an through his mother, and also because of his race, then this angered the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then he said to Abu Dharr radiallahu an, أَعَيَّرْتَهُ بِأُمِّهِ. Did you insult him because of his from his mother? Did you insult him because of his mother? إِنَّكَ مْرُؤٌ فِيكَ جَاهِلِيَّةٌ. You are a man who has jahiliyyah within him. So here the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wanted to close every avenue that leads to disputes between people, and to educate his ummah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that there is no difference because of our race and our background and our colors and the languages that we speak. Rather, those who are the best amongst us are those who are closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we find that even though we are Muslims and we hear these ahadith from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and we read these verses in the book of Allah jalla wa ala, we still find that people are proud because of their color, that people are proud because of their backgrounds, that people are proud because of their nationality. And how many times do we find Muslims fighting amongst each other because of their backgrounds? You are from this country and I am from this country. Or you are this color and you are that color. Or this is the language that you speak and this is the, this is all from jahiliyyah. Insulting people in this way, this is all from jahiliyyah. And when a person causes disputes with each other because of this, then this is from jahiliyyah, and this is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to destroy. This is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to eradicate, because this is what causes problems in the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now you would find even in the certain lands of the Muslims, they are not from our people, they are not from our tribes, they do not speak the same language as us, they are not the same color as us. So the Muslim ummah have divided because of nationality. They are divided because of their race. They are divided because of the things the Prophet ﷺ prohibited them from being divided because of. And this is why there is weakness in the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam today. Sometimes you would even find masajid. You would find masajid that there's only one race praying in that masajid, praying in that masjid. And if you find a person from a different race coming to that masjid, he'll be looked at differently. He'll be looked at in a way where he is not accepted by the people in that masjid. Kullukum, all of you are from Bani Adam, as the Prophet ﷺ said. Wa Adamu min turab, and Adam alayhi salam was from the earth. And the scholars of Islam, they mention certain principles to allow us to acknowledge the fact that we are weak, insignificant people. We have no value on this earth. We have no value on this earth, and that's why the scholars say, if you look at your beginning was droplets of despised water. Droplets of despised fluid. Can anyone ever show pride in being from droplets of despised fluid? Droplets of semen. Can anyone show pride in this? Like, this is how I began. and show that he's better than the rest of the people because he began in this way. No. So the scholar said, remember your beginning. Your beginning was droplets of despised fluids. And when you are living, you are carrying najasa, impurities in your stomach. You are carrying impurities in your body. So how can you be someone to show that you are better than those who are around you when you are carrying impurities? Something that you have no control over. Yet you are carrying this. Yes, you have to remove this from your body every day. And then they say, and your ending, how is your ending? Your ending is a rotten corpse that people will not be able to stand if it was left in front of them. If a person was to pass away and he was left in front of the creation for days or weeks or months, they will not be able to stand his smell. So they say your beginning was something that you despise. While you are living, you are carrying things that you despise. And your ending will be something that is despised. So how can a person ever show pride and arrogance and think that he is better than those who are around him? And not understanding this principle and thinking that we are better than those who are around us, this is jahiliyyah. This is jahiliyyah. If a person thinks he is better than those around him because of his race or his background, this is jahiliyyah. If a person thinks he is better than those around him because of his taqwa and his iman, then this is nifaq, this is hypocrisy. Because only the hypocrites think that their actions are good and have been accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As for the believers, they continuously blame themselves, knowing that their acts of worship are deficient. So how can a person ever have pride? وَلَا تَمْشِي فِي الْأَرْضِ مَرَحًا. As Allah Jalla wa'ala says, do not walk in this earth with pride. إِنَّكَ لَن تَخْرِقَ الْأَرْضِ وَلَن تَبْلُغَ الْجِبَالَ طُولًا. You'll not be able to pierce through this earth, and you will never reach the mountains in height. So where does the pride come from? Where does the arrogance come from? So this was the message of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to his companions. And when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said this to Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, this affected him for his entire life. So during the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and if even after he passed away, he would remember this incident when he would deal with people. Because this is how the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam were. That when they heard something, and they heard advice from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it would enter their hearts. It wouldn't just enter their ears, it would enter their hearts. And then they would change their lives based on just one piece of advice they would hear from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, he said, فَقَالَ لِلنَّبِيُّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to me, أَعَيَّرْتَهُ بِأُمِّهِ. Did you insult him through his mother? قُلْتُ نَعَمْ. I said yes. ثُمَّ قَالَ. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, إِنَّ إِخْوَانَكُمْ خَوَلُكُمْ. Indeed your brothers are something that Allah Jalla wa'ala has given you. Your brothers are something that Allah Jalla wa'ala has given you. So if they are from your slaves, they are a blessing to Allah Jalla wa'ala from you. And if they are from your companions, then they are a blessing that Allah Jalla wa'ala has given you, because they will protect you from haram, and they will protect you from the shaitan, and they will command you to do good, and they will prohibit you from evil. جَعَلَهُمُ اللَّهُ تَحْتَ أَيْدِيكُمْ. Allah has made them, put them under your hands. So more specifically to the slaves, that indeed your slaves are brothers that have been given to you. They are a gift from Allah Jalla wa'ala to you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put them under your hands. فَمَنْ كَانَ أَخُوهُ تَحْتَ يَدَيْهِ. So whoever's brother is under his hands, meaning under his possession, he owns him, he is his slave. فَلْيُطْعِمْهُ مِمَّا يَأْكُلُ. Then feed him from that which he eats himself. وَلْيُلْبِسُهُ مِمَّا يَلْبَسُ. And clothe him from that which he clothes himself. وَلَا تُكَلِّفُوهُمْ مَا يَغْلِبُهُمْ. And do not give them any duties that are too severe for them. Look at the guidance of the Prophet ﷺ. Do not give them duties that are too severe for them. فَإِن كَلَّفْتُمُوهُمْ مَا يَغْلِبُهُمْ فَأَعِينُوهُمْ. And if you give them anything that overcomes them, that is too much for them to do, فَأَعِينُوهُمْ, then help them and assist them. The Prophet ﷺ here is speaking about the slaves and how they are treated in the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Feed them with the same thing you eat. Clothe them with the same thing that you wear. Do not command them to do anything that they are unable to do. And if you ever command them to do something that is too great for them to do, then you yourself assist them in this. So this is the guidance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we find from this hadith that it is from the pre-Islamic attributes for a person to mock someone or insult him by his race or by his background or by his mother or by his parents or by anything. This is from Jahiliyyah. And this is something the Prophet ﷺ prohibited us from doing. We also find that it is not from the practice of the believers to insult one another. It is not from the practice of the believers to insult one another. We also find from this hadith that Allah Jalla wa Ala and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam have commanded us to be gentle with each other. And if they have commanded us to be gentle with the slave, and the slave is someone who is generally seen to be looked down upon, then imagine the gentleness and the mercy Allah Jalla wa Ala wants us to have with each other, with our Muslim brothers and sisters. Because the person, the master, is above the slave in rank. And if Allah Jalla wa Ala has given him such a right like this, then those who are not slave, they are more deserving to this right than even the slave. So if Allah Jalla wa Ala has commanded the rahmah and the rifq and mercy with the slave, then the general creation have more right to this mercy. We also find that this story, it happened with Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu and Bilal. And when the Prophet ﷺ said this to him, throughout his entire life, Abu Dharr, he changed the way he would deal with people. And even after the death of the Prophet ﷺ, he would clothe his slaves with exactly the same thing that he was wearing, radiallahu anhu. And we find how quick the Sahaba were to respond to the Prophet ﷺ. We also find the mercy of Al-Islam to the slaves. Even though they are people who are looked down upon in society, Allah Jalla wa Ala has raised their platform and their station in Al-Islam. And we find how the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to be humble. Because Allah Jalla wa Ala, if He is telling you to eat from that which your slave eats, so to feed your slave the same that you are feeding yourself, this brings a person's level down. It makes him realize that this life is only a test. If a person is seen wearing the same clothes as his slave outside, this will break this pride and arrogance that he may have in his heart. And pride and arrogance is from Jahiliyyah. And it's all linked to that which happened before. It's all linked to the Prophet ﷺ is seeing that you are a person that has jahiliyyah. You are looking down at these people, you are insulting them. Eat and feed them what you eat. And clothe them with what you clothe. Clothe yourself. So the Sharia of Allah Jalla wa Ala wants to break this pride. It wants to break this arrogance. And furthermore, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, if do not command them to do anything that they are unable to do. Do not command them. Because they are human beings. And they have an ability, a certain ability, and a capability to do certain things, do not command them more than this. If ever you did command them, then you yourself assist them. And this shows again tawadu. The Sharia of Allah Jalla wa Ala wants us to be humble. Imagine now a master helping his slave with his duties. The master helping his slave with his duties. And this is something is quite difficult for us to imagine some of the rulers or people of authority doing today. When we look at the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, this is how they were. And we all know the famous story of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. When the leader of Palestine, he said, I will only give the keys to your leader. So Amir al-Mu'mineen, the leader of the believers, who was Umar ibn al-Khattab, he came with his slave on that day to collect the keys. And he would ride his animal, and then he would walk and allow his slave to ride his animal. And they would alternate in this manner. Could you ever think of a person of authority or a leader doing this with their slave? He is coming to collect the keys of Jerusalem. He is coming to collect the keys of Baytul Maqdis. And he radiallahu anhu comes in this manner to the extent that when he came to the gates of Palestine, he was walking and holding his animal and his slave was riding. And they said, they looked at his garment and he had more than 6 patches on his garment. Meaning that his garment was a torn garment that he had amended. Radiallahu anhu wa arda. And then one of the Sahaba, they came to him and they said, oh Umar, what is this? You're coming to collect the keys. You're the leader of the believers. Umar, he struck him. He said, you are the last person I expected to say this to me. And we are not living for this world. We are not living for this dunya. And this is how he was, radiallahu anhu wa arda. There was no dunya in his heart whatsoever. The affairs of this world did not enter his heart. So his slave was riding while he was walking when they came to collect the keys. The enemies will see the Muslim leader coming to collect the key on foot while his slave is riding. But Umar ibn al-Khattab didn't care, radiallahu anhu. And this is how the Prophet ﷺ was able to imprint tawadu' and being humble in the hearts of his companions, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this is what Allah Jalla wa Ala wants from us. And this is what the Prophet ﷺ commanded us to do. If you command your slaves to do something which is great, then you yourself assist them. And this will break all of the avenues for the shaitan to enter from the door of pride and arrogance. Now how can a person be proud now when he is helping his slave? Where is the pride? There is no pride. He is wearing what you are wearing, he is eating what you are eating, and you are both working together. And this is from the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the mercy of the sharia, and from the hikmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to command this to destroy pride and arrogance. Because when a person is a master and he owns slaves, he'll think that he is great. So Allah Jalla wa Ala wants to bring his level down, so he acknowledges that he is a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and nothing more than this. No.
Babu hal yu'inu abda. حدثنا آدم قال حدثنا شعبة قال حدثنا أبو بشر قال سمعت سلام بن عمرو يحدث عن رجل من أصحاب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أرقاؤكم إخوانكم فأحسنوا إليهم استعينوهم على ما غلبكم وأعينوهم على ما غلبوا.
Now Imam al-Bukhari begins the following chapter. He says باب هل يعين عبده. The chapter: should a person help his slave? Now obviously this was found in the hadith before, but Imam al-Bukhari, the reason why he placed the hadith in the previous chapter is because it was referring to insulting a slave. That's why he entitled it Babu Sibab al-Abid, the chapter of insulting the slaves. So here he says Bab hal yu'inu abdahu, should a person assist his slave? And he gives a hadith. And now in this hadith, if you look at this hadith, it doesn't mention the name of the sahabi. It says, عن رجل من أصحاب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, from a man who accompanied the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And as the qa'idah that the ulama of the hadith they have given, they said, جهالة الصحابي لا تضر. That for a sahabi to be unknown does not affect the hadith. For a sahabi to a companion of the Prophet ﷺ to be unknown does not affect the hadith, because all of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ are trustworthy. So if it ever mentions that a person from the companions of the Prophet ﷺ said something, it doesn't weaken the hadith, because all of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ are trustworthy. But this hadith is weak. And why is this hadith weak? Because the person who is before the sahabi, Salam ibn Amr, it is not known that he heard from any of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ. So if it is not known that he heard from any of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, then it shows you that there is a missing link in the hadith. So the weakness is not that the sahabi has not been mentioned. The weakness is that Salam has not met a sahabi for him to narrate from the sahaba. So this is the weakness in the hadith. And even though the hadith is weak in its chain, the text of the hadith has been affirmed, as we have already seen. And the text of the hadith is established. So the benefits can be derived from the text, and the text is established in the sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَرِقَاءُكُمْ إِخْوَانُكُمْ, your slaves are your brothers. فَأَحْسِنُوا إِلَيْهِمْ, so show goodness towards them. فَأَحْسِنُوا إِلَيْهِمْ, do not just treat them how they deserve to be treated, treat them better than they deserve to be treated. Because this is what Islam calls to. Allah Jalla wa Ala calls to ihsan and perfection in everything. And this is the general principle in the sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If a person is to do anything, he shouldn't just do it just to get it out of the way. He should do it and he should perfect it. With every single one of our affairs, this is how it should be. إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَتَبَ الْإِحْسَانِ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written perfection for everything. So the Prophet ﷺ has mentioned that even when you sacrifice your animal, sharpen your blade and perfect the sacrificing of the animal. Everything that you do, you should have perfection in this. This is the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa ahsinu, as Allah Jalla wa Ala says, and He commands us, and have perfection. In Allah yuhibbul muhsinin, for indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves those who perfect their actions. So fa ahsinu ilayhim, that perfect your dealings with your slave. Ista'inuhum ala ma ghalabakum, anything that is too difficult for you, seek their help. Wa a'inuhum ala ma ghulibu, and help them in that which is too difficult for them. And this has already been explained in the previous narration. No.
حدثنا يحيى بن سليمان قال حدثني ابن وهب قال أخبرنا عمرو عن أبي يونس عن أبي هريرة أنه قال أعين العامل من عمله فإن عامل الله لا يغيب, يعني
لا يغيب,
فإن عامل الله
لا يغيب لا يخيب يعني الخادم.
الإمام البخاري يروي حديث أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه. أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه said أعين العامل من عمله. That the person who is working, assist him in his work. The person who is working, assist him in his work. Now this person, this amil, this worker, he could be anyone. He could be a person working for himself. Or as some of the ulama have mentioned, more specifically, from the verse in the Quran, وَالْعَامِلِينَ عَلَيْهَا, those who are there to distribute the zakah. So any type of person who is working, if you find a person he's working, there's hardship in his work, assist him. فَإِنَّ عَامِلَ اللَّهِ لَا يَخِيبْ. For indeed the one who is working for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the one who is working for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the person who is working in the best possible way he can work. He's working in the best possible way he can work. He is fulfilling the trust that has been put upon him. This is the one who is working for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَإِنَّ عَامِلَ اللَّهِ, this person, لَا يَخِيبْ. He will never be disappointed. He will always be successful. Because he's working for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If he finds hardship in his work, he will still be successful because he will have great reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And all of the fruits that will come from this work will be of the highest quality because he did this for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he said, Abu Huraira, he said, يَعْنِ الْخَادِمِ, like the person who is working. The person who helps, or the slave, or the servant, this is the one. He will never be disappointed. Now what is meant by this statement of Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu? It means that the person who works now, if you see a person, he is working, and he is an honest person, and he's working for the sake of Allah Jalla wa'ala, this person will always be successful. So assist him, help him. Because he is going to be rewarded for his work, and he is going to be someone who is successful. So you're going to be helping someone who is rewarded for his work, and you're also going to be helping someone that Allah Jalla wa'ala possibly likes. So he could be a friend of Allah Jalla wa'ala. He could be an awliya, he could be a wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And helping the friend of Allah Jalla wa ala is something which is great in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now from this narration we find that when a person has been entrusted with something, he should fulfill this trust to the best of his ability. And if he fulfills this trust to the best of his ability, then he will be the one who is doing this for the sake of Allah, so his entire livelihood could become an ibadah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We find sometimes people are entrusted with certain things and they are working. They are not actually working. They are missing time, but they sign themselves in as if they are there. They are not working, they are not spending time. If it was their own business, they would try their best to fulfill the trust. They would try their best to work as hard as they can, so they can make as much profit and be successful in their business. But because they are working for someone else, they do not give this effort. This person is not sincere in his work to this person. And he's not given perfection in his work. The Sharia of Allah Jalla wa'ala wants us to perfect everything. Wants us to be sincere. Wants us to fulfill our amanat. If we are entrusted to do something, we will do it in the best possible way, seeking the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if a person does this, and he works in the best possible way, and he seeks the reward of Allah Jalla wa'ala, then this person, فَإِنَّ عَامِلَ اللَّهِ لَا يَخِيبْ. That the one who works for the sake of Allah Jalla wa'ala, he will never be disappointed. He will be successful in this world. Why? Because firstly, he can guarantee that his money is halal. His wealth is halal. His time that he has used because he is thinking about Allah Jalla wa'ala and perfecting it because Allah Jalla wa'ala told him, he has worked outside for 5 hours, for 8 hours, for 10 hours. This has all become an ibadah on his scale. He will earn the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And through the pleasure of Allah Jalla wa'ala and the mercy of Allah, he will earn Jannah. And this is what the believer wants. So this is what is meant, فَإِنَّ عَامِلَ اللَّهِ لَا يَخِيبْ. That the one who works for the sake of Allah Jalla wa'ala, he will never be disappointed. And he said, يَعْنِ الْخَادِمْ. Abu Huraira said, yes, meaning the servant. So now he's telling you even the servant. If a person is a slave, he should work for his master. And he should work in the best possible way for him. Even if he finds hardship in this, because this is his duty now. He is fulfilling his duty towards him. And he may find it to be hard now, but the fruits are great in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he will see the reward when he is with Allah Jalla wa'ala, and that reward will be great, so he will be successful in this life, because blessing and barakah will be placed in his life, and he'll be successful in the akhirah, because the pleasure of Allah Jalla wa'ala will be for him in the akhirah. And this fulfills the statement of Imam al-Bukhari, بَابُ هَلْ يُعِينُ عَبْدَهُ. Should a person assist his slave? Yes, he should assist his slave. And he should even assist his workers if they are unable to fulfill that which he has given them to do.
باب لا يكلف العبد من العمل ما لا يطيق. حدثنا عبد الله بن يزيد قال حدثنا سعيد بن أبي أيوب قال حدثنا ابن عجلان عن بكير بن عبد الله عن عجلان عن أبي هريرة عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال المملوك طعامه وكسوته لا يكلف من العمل ما لا يطيق.
So Imam al-Bukhari now is reiterating the points that he has mentioned in the previous hadith. He said, بَابٌ لَا يُكَلَّفُ الْعَبْدُ مِنَ الْعَمَلِ مَا لَا يُطِيقُ. The chapter that it is not delegated to a slave, a work is not delegated to a slave that more than he can bear. So you do not delegate work to anyone more than they can bear. And then he gives the hadith of Abi Huraira radiallahu anhu, which is in the Sahih of Imam Muslim, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لِلْمَمْلُوكِ طَعَامُهُ وَكِسْوَتُهُ. For the slave is his food and his clothing. So the master has to provide his food for him. He has to provide his clothing. وَلَا يُكَلَّفُ مِنَ الْعَمَلِ مَا لَا يُطِيقُ. And he is not given any duties more than he is able to bear. He is not given any duties more than he can bear. So we find from this hadith that it is obligatory upon the master to provide the slave with food and drink and clothing. And it is not permissible for him to give him more work than he can bear. Now the Prophet ﷺ has mentioned this regarding the slave. And the slave is someone who belongs to the master. So the scholars say, what about those now workers that a person is paying to do work for him? Sometimes you find, and this happens, and this is the sad reality, but it happens in many Muslim countries, where they would find workers from poorer countries and they would employ them, and then they would treat them worse than the slave should be treated. They would treat them worse than they would treat slaves. And they would make them do work that you would not even think of a slave even doing these types of work. And you find this, and this is the sad reality in many of the Muslim countries. So if the Prophet ﷺ said regarding the slave, وَلَا يُكَلَّفُ مِنَ الْعَمَلِ مَا لَا يُطِيقُ, that the slave is not given more work than he is able to do, then what about the actual worker, the person who is getting paid, who is doing this job? How could you make him do certain things which no human being would do? And you command him to do certain things, even there was a time, subhanAllah, this is the general norm that you would find in certain countries, that even when the dustbin trucks they come, the workers, first they get paid hardly anything. Secondly, they are made to go inside the bins and look for things with their hands. And then to throw certain things away and to keep certain things or put certain things to the side. Only certain things can go into the truck, other things have to be placed in other trucks and containers. This is a well-known fact. And you see, when you walk past just these bins, you can't even stand the smell of this. So what about the person who has to go inside it? And what is inside there? All of the filth that people put from their houses. Najasa, impurities, all of these things. But they are made to work in certain ways. They are made sometimes to stand in the heat and they're not allowed to cover themselves or cover their heads. And they have to wear certain garments which will even make it harder for them to work in certain countries. And this is not how a Muslim should be treated. No human being should be treated in this way. So the Prophet ﷺ says regarding the slave, وَلَا يُكَلَّفُ مِنَ الْعَمَلِ مَا لَا يُطِيقُ, that you do not give him any duties more than he can do. And this isn't just for the slave, this is for everyone. Sometimes you have workers that come to your house, you're trying to tell them to do certain things, you know they cannot do. If you can assist them, assist them. If they can't do it, employ more people so they can do it. But never treat someone in a way that you will not like to be treated yourself. And the scholar said this is the general principle for every chapter with regards to dealing with people. Treat those who are around you the same way you would like to be treated yourself. Treat those who are around you the same way you would like to be treated yourself. If you go into a shop and you're asking someone for something, ask them in the same way you would like to be asked if you were in their position. If you are work, if you've got a worker and he's doing something for you, ask him and command him in the same way that you would like to be, you would like to receive these orders if you were in his position. And this is the way a person should deal with people. And if he deals with people in this manner, then he knows that he will be successful in this dunya and the akhirah. Because he has now wished for his brothers that which he wishes for himself. And this is the qa'idah that we will come to inshallah ta'ala in this kitab that the Prophet ﷺ, he mentions.
حدثنا عبد الله قال حدثني الليث قال حدثني ابن عجلان عن بكير عن عجلان عن أن أجلان أبا محمد حدثه قبيل وفاته أنه سمع أبا هريرة يقول قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم للمملوك طعامه وكسوته ولا يكلف إلا ما يطيق.
The Imam Bukhari repeats his hadith also from the authority of Abu Huraira, and he said للمملوكي, that the Prophet ﷺ said للمملوك طعامه وكسوته, that the person who is a slave, upon him is he deserves his food and his clothing, ولا يكلف إلا ما يطيق, and he is not given any duties more than he can bear. And he mentions an addition in the chain that Ajlan with Abu Muhammad, he mentioned this hadith قُبَيْلَ وَفَاتِهِ, just before he passed away. And for the fact that this was one of the advices he gave to the people just before he passed away, shows the importance of this matter. So it shows you that people will look down at their slaves and people will mistreat them. So he, even just before he passed away, he gave this advice that he heard Abu Huraira say, that the Prophet ﷺ said, upon your slaves is their food and their clothing, and do not give them duties more than they can bear.
حدثنا مسدد قال حدثنا يحيى عن الأعمش قال قال معرور مررنا بأبي ذر وعليه ثوب وعلى غلامه حلة فقلنا لو أخذت هذا وأعطيت هذا غيرك كانت حلة قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إخوانكم جعلهم الله عز وجل تحت أيديكم فمن كان أخوه تحت يده فليطعمه مما يأكل ويلبسه مما يلبس ولا يكلفه ما يغلبه فإن كلفه ما يغلبه فليعنه عليه.
Now Imam Bukhari gives the hadith again of Abi Dharr radiallahu anhu. So he says, قال معرور مررنا بأبي ذر وعليه ثوب وعلى غلامه حلة. That we walked past Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, and he was wearing a thawb, he was wearing a garment. وعلى غلامه حلة, and his slave was wearing a robe. فَقُلْنَا لَوْ أَخَذْتَ هَذَا وَأَعْطَيْتَ هَذَا غَيْرَهُ. If you were to take this and you were to give this to other than him, لَكَانَتْ حُلَّةً, it will become a complete set. Meaning that why are you wearing the clothes like this? This hadith has already preceded us. So he said that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, إِخْوَانُكُمْ جَعْلَهُمُ اللَّهُ تَحْتَ أَيْدِيكُمْ. That your brothers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put them under your hands, under your responsibility. فَمَنْ كَانَ أَخُوهُ تَحْتَ يَدِهِ, whoever's brother is under his hand, فَلْيُطْعِمْهُ مِمَّا يَأْكُلْ, then let him feed him with that which he eats. وَلْيُلْبِسْهُ مِمَّا يَلْبَسْ, and let him clothe him with that which he wears. وَلَا يُكَلِّفْهُ مَا يَغْلِبُهُ, and do not give him duties that overcome him. فَإِنْ كَلَّفَهُ مَا يَغْلِبُهُ فَلْيُعِنْهُ عَلَيْهِ, and if you give him any duties that are too difficult for him, then assist him in this. And this hadith has preceded us in number 189. And the hadith is muttafaqun alayh.
باب النفقة الرجل على عبده وخادمه صدقة. حدثنا إبراهيم بن موسى قال أخبرنا بقية قال أخبرني بحير بن سعد عن خالد بن معدان عن المقدام سمع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول ما أطعمت نفسك فهو صدقة وما أطعمت ولدك وزوجتك وخادمك فهو صدقة.
إمام البخاري says باب نفقة الرجل على عبده وخادمه صدقة. The chapter of a person spending upon his slave and his helpers is a charity. The chapter of a person spending upon his slave and his helpers or his servants is a sadaqah, is a charity. And he gives the hadith of Al-Miqdam radiallahu anhu, that the Prophet sallallahu, that he heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, مَا أَطْعَمْتَ نَفْسَكَ فَهُوَ صَدَقَةً, that which you feed yourself is a charity. وَمَا أَطْعَمْتَ وَلَدَكَ وَزَوْجَتَكَ وَخَادِمَكَ فَهُوَ صَدَقَةً, and that which you feed your child and your spouse and your servant is a sadaqah. Now this hadith has preceded us in the earlier chapters of this kitab, or that which is similar to this has preceded us. And we mentioned that if a person doesn't intend reward through this, and it just becomes a habit for him to spend upon himself and his family, then he has done that which has been required from him. He has fulfilled the obligation that is required from him. But if he wants more reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala,
And he wants it to not just be that which suffice, that which lifts the obligation upon him. He wants it to be that which lifts an obligation from him, and also additional charity that he has given, then he should look for the reward every time he spends. And this is from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the mercy that Allah jalla wa'ala has placed in his sharia. That when a person even spends upon himself, it is a charity. مَا أَطْعَمْتَ نَفْسَكَ فَهُوَ صَدَقَةٌ. That which you spend on yourself is a sadaqah. So when you buy yourself food, when you buy yourself clothing, when you buy anything for yourself, this is a sadaqah if you have the intention that I'm doing this for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you buy something and you are the head of the household, Allah jalla wa ala says, الرِّجَالُ قَوَّامُونَ عَلَى النِّسَى, that the men are the maintainers of the women. It is the responsibility of the man to buy food for his family, for his wife and his children. It is his responsibility to clothe them. It is his responsibility to shelter them and to fulfill their needs. Every time he does this now, if he remembers Allah Jalla wa Ala and he looks for the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he'll be given charity. Every time you put food on their plate, it is charity. So a person in Yawm al-Qiyamah, he would have done what every person does. But because he reminded himself that this is an ibadah, and he thought about this at the time of spending, his station will be higher than the person who didn't think about this. And this is why the Prophet ﷺ, he said, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ, that indeed actions are by the intentions. وَإِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مَّا نَوَى, and everyone will be rewarded for that which he has intended. Indeed actions are by the intentions, and everyone will be rewarded for what they have intended. So the Sharia of Allah Jalla wa Ala wants us to renew our intention every time we're going to do something. Because renewing the intention every time a person does something reminds him of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It reminds him of Allah Jalla wa Ala. It reminds him of the Akhirah. And it reminds him of the blessings that Allah Jalla wa Ala has given him. Because if a person now is just going to spend on himself and his family, khalas, he spent on them. But just when he's about to spend, he stops and he says things to himself, if I'm going to make a good intention now, I'll be rewarded by Allah Jalla wa Ala. So now he reminds himself that Allah Jalla wa Ala has commanded me to spend on my family, and I'm spending on them to receive the reward of Allah. This is what he intends. I'm spending on them to receive the reward of Allah Jalla wa Ala. He has now remembered Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he's been from those that were dhakirin Allah kathira, from those who remember Allah Jalla wa Ala frequently. He's been like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, kana yadhkuru Allah fi kulli ahyanihi. He remembers Allah jalla wa ala in all of his affairs. He's about to spend, he's going to do this anyway, but now he's remembered Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This will now allow him to acknowledge that Allah jalla wa ala is the one who has given him this wealth in the first place. Allah is the one who has blessed him with everything that he has. And this is the fa'idah that we find in the sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the benefit that we find in the sharia of Allah jalla wa ala, when we are told to do ihtisab. We are told to think about the reward for the deed. Because this reminds us of Allah Jalla wa Ala, and this increases us in our iman. And it reminds us of many things after this. Many doors of khair can open after this. A person remembers Allah Jalla wa Ala, then he remembers the blessings that Allah Jalla wa Ala gave him. He remembers that what he's about to spend doesn't even actually belong to him. It is a gift to him from Ar-Razzaq. It is a gift to him from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So then he thanks Allah Jalla wa Ala for this gift. And then he remembers that Allah Jalla wa Ala has given him so many gifts, that everything that he has in this life is a ni'mah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he remembers the fact that he cannot count the blessings even if he tried. وَإِنْ تَعُدُّ نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. Even if he were to try and count the blessings, he cannot count them. Then he remembers on top of this, that if he is to be thankful for these blessings, he will be given more by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If he doesn't thank Allah Jalla wa Ala for these blessings, they'll be taken away from him. So all just thinking about the reward for giving the sadaqah, or buy, or just before you spend or you purchase, just thinking about the reward would open up so many other avenues of good deeds. And this is how it brings a person closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is how the scholars say we reflect over ahadith like this from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because this is, just thinking about this is such a ni'mah from Allah jalla wa ala, that now you have to spend on yourself in order to survive. Think about the reward just before you purchase. Think about the reward just before you consume. Just before you eat, just before you drink. Think about the reward just before you buy the food for your family, just before you take it to your house. Think about the food. Think about the reward just when you are going to spend and purchase clothes for them. Or when you're paying the rent, or you're paying for the electricity bill or the gas bill, think about the reward just before you do this. And this becomes a great sadaqah for you in front of Allah Jalla wa Ala. And this sadaqah is burhan. Now imagine now, you're just before you're going into this, just before you're going to give the bill, the electric bill or the gas bill or the rent, you have the intention now and you remind yourself of this, and you can even say this. Say, oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have been the one who has commanded me to give sadaqah. This is my sadaqah for my family. And I ask you, Allah, because you have promised me to increase this, or increase this for me. You can make this dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah jalla wa ala said, وَمَنْ يُقْرِضِ اللَّهَ قَرْضًا حَسَنًا فَيُضَاعِفَهُ لَهُ أَضْعَافًا كَثِيرًا. Whoever gives Allah jalla wa ala a loan, Allah jalla wa ala will multiply it for him. So this is the sadaqah. So just like we give sadaqah to the poor and the needy, you have the intention that, oh Allah, I'm giving this sadaqah for you, and I know you will give me something that I cannot imagine in the akhirah because of this. But I also, you also remind yourself that this is something that Allah will multiply for you in this world. For spending on yourself, Allah will multiply your wealth. For spending on your wife and your children, Allah Jalla wa Ala will multiply your wealth, because it's a sadaqah. And reminding yourself of this constantly, every time you're about to spend, every time you're about to spend, you remind yourself this. What would this encourage you to do? This will encourage you to spend more. This will encourage you to spend more on yourself. This will encourage you to spend more on your families. Sometimes we find brothers, they don't like to spend on their families. They'll spend on themselves, they'll go out to eat with their friends, they'll spend time with their friends, they'll spend money on their friends. But when it comes to their family, they don't want to spend on their family. No, this is a sadaqah that you're giving to your family. And you should want to spend on your family, because it pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it will bring you close to Him in the akhirah. There should never be a sister complaining, saying that my husband is not spending on me. He has money, but he's not spending on me. There should never be a complaint like this. Because the husband should see that this is something that Allah Jalla wa Ala is blessing me through. This is something that will give me a station in the akhirah. This is something that will raise my platform in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this should encourage him just to spend on his family. He should spend on them, he should give them gifts, he should purchase for them their food, their clothes, give them extra than that which they need. Do ihsan towards them. But every time he does this, he should look for the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the marriage will become stronger like this. There'll be more barakah placed in his life. He will have more wealth because he has given sadaqah now. And this is just khair upon khair, it's goodness upon goodness. And this is what we are encouraged to do in the sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Prophet said, مَا أَطْعَمْتَ نَفْسَكَ فَهُوَ صَدَقَةً. That which you feed yourself is a charity. وَمَا أَطْعَمْتَ وَلَدَكَ وَزَوْجَتَكَ وَخَادِمَكَ فَهُوَ صَدَقَةً. And that which you feed your child and your wife and your servant, this is a sadaqah. So the author here, he is saying from the chapter, بَابُ نَفَقَةُ الرَّجُلِ بَابُ نَفَقَةُ الرَّجُلِ عَلَىٰ عَبْدِهِ وَخَادِمِهِ صَدَقَةً. The chapter of a person spending upon his slave and his helpers or servants is a sadaqah, because even your servant now, you spending on him is a sadaqah from you, even though he belongs to you and he is someone, something that you own, but taking care of him is a sadaqah and something that you will be rewarded for with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
حدثنا مسدد قال حدثنا حماد بن زيد عن عاصم بن بهدلة عن أبي صالح عن أبي هريرة قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم خير صدقة ما بقى غنى واليد العليا خير من اليد السفلى وابدأ بمن تعول تقول امرأتك أنفق علي أو طلقني ويقول مملوكك أنفق علي أو بعني ويقول ولدك
Now Imam al-Bukhari gives the hadith of Abi Hurairah radiallahu anhu wa arda. And the hadith of Abi Hurairah is in the Sahih of Imam al-Bukhari, where he said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, خَيْرُ الصَّدَقَةِ مَا بَقَّى غِنًا. خَيْرُ الصَّدَقَةِ مَا بَقَّى غِنًا. Now this is a very important principle in the sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when we hear the Prophet ﷺ saying things like khayru something, that the best of something, then it's something that a Muslim should pay attention to. So here the Prophet ﷺ is saying the best of sadaqah. What is the best type of sadaqah you can give? مَا بَقَّى غِنًا. That which, if you have given the sadaqah, you still have something left for yourself. This is the best type of sadaqah. The best type of sadaqah is not to get all of your wealth and give it in charity. This is not the best type of sadaqah. The best type of sadaqah is to give sadaqah and keep that and keep something for yourself and your family and those who you are responsible for. Because how could you give everything away and then those who you are responsible for are going to be neglected? This is not called sadaqah. Because remember, even giving it to them is sadaqah as well. And they have a right over you that those who are further do not have that right. So the Prophet said, خَيْرُ صَدَقَ مَا بَقَّ غِنًا. The best sadaqah is that which a person, there is wealth that remains behind with him after it. Then the Prophet gives another principle, another qa'idah. وَالْيَدُ الْعُلْيَا خَيْرٌ مِنَ الْيَدِ السُّفْلَى. The upper hand is better than the lower hand. The upper hand is better than the lower hand. So the one who gives is better than the one who receives. So when a person gives sadaqah, he is the upper hand. And this is why we are all encouraged to give sadaqah. And sometimes people say, I just want to live on the smallest amount of wage that I can have, and inshallah I can survive. But khalas, you're not going to be from those who have the upper hand. And that's why it is important for Muslims to flourish in this dunya. It is important for Muslims to be wealthy in this life. Because if they are not wealthy, then who is going to take care of the orphans? Who is going to take care of the widows? Who is going to give water to the poor? Who is going to build them houses and masajid and shelter? Who is going to give them clothing and food? So it is important that Muslims are wealthy. And if a person gains wealth for this reason, then his wealth is an ibadah. His profession is an ibadah. And we find many brothers, they're just satisfied with just taking that which is sufficient. It's good you can live your life like this and you can be simple like this. There's no problem. But you're losing out on the reward of giving the sadaqah. So the Prophet said, وَالْيَدُ الْعُلْيَا خَيْرٌ مِنَ الْيَدِ السُّفْلَى. The upper hand is better than the lower hand. And sometimes we also find that brothers and sisters are not ashamed of asking even when they do not have the need. Brothers and sisters sometimes are not ashamed of asking even when they are not in need. And the Prophet is reminding us all that the upper hand is better than the lower hand. Like sometimes people like to portray that they do not have anything. Maybe they like people to feel sorry for them. They like to get attention from people, or they think it's a way for them to increase in their wealth. So they'll always portray that they are in need. So then people will give them and they'll give them just out of their generosity to help them, but they are not really in need. The Prophet doesn't want us to be like this. And our hadith pertaining to this, inshallah ta'ala, will come later in the kitab, so we'll not go through it here. So the Prophet is telling us the upper hand is always better than the lower hand. So try and be from those who give and not from those who ask. Be from those who give and not from those who ask. And then the Prophet gives another principle in this hadith. He says, وَبْدَأْ بِمَنْ تَعُولُ. Begin with those who it is obligatory, who their rights are obligatory upon you. وَبْدَأْ بِمَنْ تَعُولُ. So even when you give now, so the whole context of this hadith is pertaining to sadaqah. Give sadaqah, but when you give sadaqah, always have something that remains for yourself. That's number one. Secondly, be from those who give frequently. And give, because the upper hand is better than the lower hand. And when you give now, begin with those who you are responsible for before those who are further away from you. So a person now, his family needs food or his relatives need food, but he's going to give food to someone that he doesn't know. It's khair, there is good to give it to someone that you do not know, but your family have more rights over you. So you will begin with those who are closest to you, from your parents and your children and your spouses. You give it to those who are closest, and then those who are further away, maybe your relatives, your uncles and your aunties and your cousins and your nephews and your siblings, you give it to those who are closest, and then those who are further away. So the Prophet said, وَبْدَأْ بِمَنْ تَعُولُ. Because those who are closer to you have more rights than those who are further than you. As we took in the previous chapters. They may be close to you because of qaraba, but they have, because of their lineage, they are close to you. Or they may be close to you because of their religion, Islam. Or they may be close to you because they are your neighbors. So they might have more rights over you than those who maybe you do not know. So give to those who have more rights over you. And then give to those who come after them. Then it says, تَقُولِ امْرَأَتُكْ. From this point of the hadith, it is the statement of Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu. So this hadith is mudraj. And mudraj means that one of the sahaba have entered his statement into the hadith. So some of the scholars, they were unable to differentiate between what was the statement of the Prophet ﷺ and what was the statement of the Sahaba. And the specialists of hadith, they are able to tell the difference between the statement of the Prophet ﷺ and the Sahaba by looking at the other narrations and the pathways in which the narrations have come to us. So when it says, تَقُولِ امْرَأَتُكْ, and your wife would say, this is from the statement of Abu Huraira, and this is not from the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this reason how the scholars know this is from the statement of Abu Huraira is because in another narration Abu Huraira says, and I said this. So this shows that this is from the statement of Abu Huraira and this is not from the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. تَقُولِ امْرَأَتُكْ أَنْفِقْ عَلَيَّ أَوْ تَلِّقْنِي. Your wife would say, spend on me or divorce me. وَيَقُولُ مَمْلُوكُكْ, and your slave would say, أَنْفِقْ عَلَيَّ أَوْ بِعْنِي. Spend on me or sell me. وَيَقُولُ وَلَدُكْ, and your child will say, إِلَى مَنْ تَتِّبُنَا. Now who would you leave us to? So Abu Huraira, he is saying this because if a person now was to give everything in sadaqah and not have anything that is remaining for himself, how is he going to fulfill the rights of his wife? So she has the right to say, spend on me or divorce me. Because you are supposed to take care of me and now you've given everything away. How am I going to survive? So she has the right to say this. And she will say this if you do not leave anything for her. And your slave would say, spend on me or sell me to someone else, someone that can take care of me, because you are not taking care of me. And then your child, the miskin, will say, who are you going to leave me to? Because you can't give me to anyone else. So Abu Huraira is saying, this is going to be the reality of a person who gives everything away. So now someone would ask, but why did Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu give everything away? Didn't Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu give all of his wealth away? Yes, he gave all of his wealth away. And that's why he was on a different level to everyone else. He was someone who would go out and he would work and he would get money and he knows that he would go. His level of reliance upon Allah Jalla wa Ala was higher than everyone else from this ummah after the Anbiya. His level of reliance upon Allah Jalla wa Ala was the most. He would strive harder than anyone else. He had more patience so he would be able to take poverty, and he had instilled this in his family so his family were able to remain patient. So when Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu gave everything away, he knew that he's going to go out, he's going to do tijara, he's going to do business, and he's going to have enough to fulfill his obligations as well. So if a person, the scholars say, if a person is able to do what Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu did, then it is permissible. So let's say, for example, a person, he has a certain amount of money in his account, and he knows that tomorrow is going to be the day that he's going to be paid from work. Because it's permissible for him to give all of that money today, as long as he has fulfilled the obligations that are needed for today. It's permissible for him to give everything in sadaqah today, because he knows that his money is going to come tomorrow. So like Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he knows that he's going to do tijara, he knows that he's going to be able to receive money. So for this reason, he gave everything away, relying on Allah Jalla wa Ala that he has always gone out to seek the earnings in this world, and Allah Jalla wa Ala has always helped him. So he had this level of reliance, he had something that he would do, he would perform this, and then he would spend on his family. Yeah.
حدثنا محمد بن كثير قال أخبرنا سفيان عن محمد بن عجلان عن المقبوري عن أبي هريرة قال أمر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بصدقة وقال رجل عندي دينار قال أنفقه على نفسك قال عندي آخر قال أنفقه على زوجتك قال عندي آخر قال أنفقه على خادمك ثم أنت أبصر.
Now Imam al-Bukhari gives the hadith of Abi Hurairah رضي الله عنه. He said, أَمَرَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ بِصَدَقَةً. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم commanded the sadaqah, commanded us to give charity. فَقَالَ رَجُلٌ, so a man, he said, عِنْدِي دِنَار, I have a dinar. So he's asking the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, now, what is the best place for me to put this dinar? Where should I spend this dinar? He said, I have a dinar. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, أَنْفِقْهُ عَلَى نَفْسِكْ. Spend it on yourself. Fulfill your obligations, because you have more right to this than anyone else. So spend it on yourself. قَالَ عِنْدِي آخَرَ, he says, and I have another dinar. The Prophet said, أَنْفِقْهُ عَلَى زَوْجَتِكْ, spend it on your wife. قَالَ عِنْدِي آخَرَ, he said, I have another one. The Prophet said, أَنْفِقْهُ عَلَى خَادِمِكْ, spend it on your slave. ثُمَّ أَنْتَ أَبْصَرَ, and then you are better knowing who deserves it after that. So this is similar to the hadith before, وَبْدَأْ بِمَنْ تَعُولُ, begin with those who have more rights. So if you have wealth, you spend it on yourself first. Then you will spend it on your family. Then those will extend after them and then after them. And this is how the Sharia of Allah Jalla wa Ala has commanded us to spend our wealth. We'll take a short break here inshaAllah ta'ala. And then we'll continue with the dars.
after the break.